The thing about this list, these in and out list, that terrifies me is that what it does is, I think it directs, it basically says that support workers are great and fine and you can spend all your money on support workers, but is that really the way to live an inclusive life?
And at the federal court, found something really interesting. They found that the NDIA and then the AAT had both made a mistake. And that mistake was they weren't following the two-step process. So the two-step process, and forgive me if I get a bit dry here, but this is clearly my passion. The two-step process is...
Hi, I'm Dr. George Thorpe-Morris, and welcome to Reasonable and Necessary, Australia's premier podcast series on the National Disability Insurance Scheme, brought to you by the Soul Foundation. I'm coming to you from Wurundjeri land and pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging. But before we go any further, please do me a favour and hit the like button, subscribe to the channel and select the notification bell so you can be notified of future episodes. In this episode, I'm joined by Sam Paior from the Growing Space and Chris Keynes from DSC. We discuss the government's attempt to define an NDIS support. We examine the draft list of NDIS supports and consider what should and should not be included. We also discuss what might be some unintended consequences of narrowing the definition of an NDIS support. Check it out. Hey guys, welcome to the show.
Hey!
Hi George.
Great to have you on. How about we start by introducing ourselves? Can I start with you, Chris?
Yeah, hi George. I'm Chris Coombes. I'm dialing in from the lands of the Yagara and Turrbal peoples. And I pay my respects to your listeners, some of whom may be from First Nations communities. My background, I currently write for Team DSC, and I have a history of working in and around the NDIS, including as an independent expert reviewer for matters that go all the way to the Administrative Appeals Tribunal.
Hi. Thanks for having me, George, and great to have you here too, Chris. I'm on Kaurna land, the Adelaide Plains, and I want to pay my deep respects to the Kaurna people and their ancestors and elders. I'm with the Growing Space, an independent support coordination organisation. I am also a parent of a couple of participants in the NDIS, and I'm a member of the Independent Advisory Council, the Intellectual Disability Reference Group, and a whole lot of other stuff like that.
So good to have both of you. We're going to talk about some huge changes that could be heading to our NDIS. It all depends on the legislation and what happens there. The NDIS definition is being looked at right now. And Chris, I'd like to get your thoughts on why is the government wanting to change the definition of what an NDIS support is?
Yeah, thanks, George. So it's a great question. There's been many reports in the last 5-10 years that have talked about the complexity of the NDIS. And what we've been hearing recently in the Senate inquiry is about that complexity and what that looks like and feels like to be on the end of a reassessment process. And I think the most recent report that we can cite is the 10-year review, which we're still waiting for a government response on. And this review talked about a few things. It talked about the need for easier, more consistent planning processes. It talked about the need for clarity. And I think this week we just saw CEO Rebecca Falkingham say that we've been terrible at the NDIS, and this is her language, we've been terrible at explaining what participants can and cannot spend their NDIS funds on. The other thing that the 10-year review report talked about was flexibility. And I want to use their words here because it's important. Action 3.5, it says, the NDIA should allow for greater flexibility in how participants can spend their budget with minimal exceptions, end quote. The last one, of course, your listeners will all know about, and that's because you can't unhear it. It's all of the sustainability language that is coming from the media, or certain corners from the media mainly. This bill seeks to achieve scheme sustainability and cost savings, and the government has not been secret about that as well. So, yeah, I guess that's a high-level overview of what I personally think the government is trying to achieve with the clarification of an NDIS support.
Sam, you're a big advocate for self-management and self-direction. How do you feel about all this? Because there will be some consequences here for participants and for how participants can use their funds flexibly and creatively, right?
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. Look, I'm pretty nervous about what I'm seeing. I think that, you know, if the aim of all of this is to spend less money on the NDIS, then that's one thing. But telling people how they can spend that money once it's been assigned doesn't add to that. It doesn't reduce the spend. It just means that people don't have the flexibility and they don't have that self-direction and they don't have that autonomy to live life the way that they want to live it in an inclusive way. I think on a really big picture, the thing about this list, these in and out list that terrifies me is that what it does is I think it basically says that support workers are great and fine and you can spend all your money on support workers, but is that really the way to live an inclusive life? If I could wear a smartwatch that alerts someone to when I fall over when I'm running to the bus stop, isn't that better than having to have a support worker shadow me everywhere I go? So I'm really, I don't want this to have a really perverse outcome, and I think that there is a risk of that.
And I know that, you know, both you and I work a lot with people with disabilities who are self-managing, and one of the reasons why we love doing it is because we can find some great ways of using our funding to make the funding go further.
Yeah.
And so when you say about sustainable and saving money, I wonder, is that always going to be the case with a list that, yes, there's support workers, yes, smartwatches, no. So
yeah,
there's going to be lots more of those examples, but we're going to go through those in a second. Before I do, Chris, I know that you love the law. You love learning about the way the NDIS and the federal court and the AOT make decisions. And recently, the federal court, I understand, made a decision around what is a daily living expense. And I found that very, very helpful because often people are told, no, you can't buy that. That's a daily living expense. Tell us more about what the court had to say on that.
Yeah, it's true. It's been an area of the law that's needed clearing up for 10 years, really. And finally, this year, a person made it all the way to the federal court. And for context, it's not easy or cheap to get to the federal court. There's a very long process. And to tell you about this process, I'm going to talk about Mr. W. So Mr. W was the person in the court case. And Mr. W lived with a disability that was progressive. And that meant because of his support needs, he couldn't live in his home anymore and he needed to move. He went to the agency and he said, hey, can you fund my moving costs? The NDIA said, no, sorry, we can't. And he wasn't happy with that decision, so he internally reviewed it And eventually he found himself at the Administrative Appeals Tribunal. The tribunal looked at it and looked at the moving costs and looked at his situation and said, they don't solely and directly relate to your disability. Because Mr. W is resilient, he said, I'm not accepting that as an answer. I'm going to the federal court. And at the federal court found something really interesting. They found that the NDIA and then the AAT had both made a mistake. And that mistake was they weren't following the two-step process. So the two-step process, and forgive me if I get a bit dry here, but this is clearly my passion. The two-step process is, so is the support a day-to-day living expense, right? Is the moving costs a day-to-day living expense? The second step is, if it is a day-to-day living expense, does it solely and directly relate to your disability? Right. So the mistake the NDIA made is they jumped straight to the second bit of the test. They didn't properly understand how moving costs or whether moving costs were day-to-day living expenses. And the federal court, the judge said, well, they're not. Right. Moving costs are not day-to-day living costs. Right. They're extraordinary. So what is a day-to-day living what is a day-to-day living cost according to the federal court? It's those expenses which are incurred in the course of living for the purpose of living. And I think what they mean there are really kind of day-to-day ongoing necessities. So I'm going to leave it there. Sam, did you want to add anything? Because I know you were following this court case as well.
Yeah, not really. Just that I think that this day-to-day part is really relevant for this NDIS supports because the carve-outs are all based on day-to-day supports, and I don't think the agency have got it right in this list.
Because in that case, this person had to move because of their disability, right? But they wouldn't have to move otherwise. So why was the agency wanting to take this to the federal court?
It's a really good question, George. I think maybe a generous response is that we did need clarity on the law. We needed clarity on what day-to-day living costs were. And perhaps that's a reason why they didn't agree at an earlier stage.
Now, the list has been released for us all to have a look at and to give our feedback. I want to get your feedback, and I'd really like to get a sense from both of you about what you like about it and also what you think we need to consider around improving this list. Can I start with you, Chris?
Yeah, so what I like about this list... what I like about it is that it does provide people with a level of consistency so they're not calling up the NDIS and getting conflicting advice necessarily. I think there's a whole bunch of grey in there where that might actually happen, but the intent of it is for people to arrive at clarity. I think the NDIS is a labyrinth and a maze, and the more clear guidance the better in most circumstances. The other thing I like about the minister being able to table the lists in the Senate is it gives a direct way of the public, if they're not happy with those lists, to lobby and advocate for something different. So in the future, if people aren't happy with a list, someone could run on a platform of getting thermo mixers back into the NDIS or something like getting smartwatches back into the NDIS.
I'm interested, though. We've been given 14 days, though, right? So I'm just wondering, how does this fit with the whole promise around co-design? Our first example of... working out what this legislation is going to look like has been a survey on a government website, and for them to fill it out. And there have been some consultations with the disability representative organisations, but is that enough, Sam? Can I ask you?
It's a good question. I understand the the timeframes are really difficult because once the law is passed, there's only 28 days. If the law is passed, there's only 28 days for this stuff to be in place. So they have to do a whole lot of work now, and they've got to do it really quickly because if this bill gets passed, we have to have the rules ready to rock and roll. Now, they are transitional rules, which means that they will be reviewed and we've got promises from government that they'll be co-designed after the after they're in. But of course, there's no time frame, there's no timeline on how long before the transitional rules are replaced by others. And of course, they have to be approved by all the state governments. So if the state governments don't agree with whatever changes or with whatever we come up with in co-design, then we're stuck with these transitional rules effectively infinitum. I'm a little bit nervous about that.
Yeah, I think that we're all just wondering what this is going to mean for us. Sam, is there anything that you do like about this?
I like the clarity around what's in. I think it's really nice to have some better ideas about what sort of things people can or should be spending their money on. I think that that's really valuable. And in the out list, there's a whole lot of stuff in the out list that, average Joe would not believe and would need to be listed. Like, you can't spend your NDIS money on gambling or guns or alcohol. To you and I, that's pretty obvious. But people have been doing those things. So it's good to have those sorts of things on the list. The rest of it, I'm not feeling quite so comfortable about at this point.
Okay. Let's get to the list now. I'm really keen to hear from both of you. What are the things on the list that you find most problematic? Can I start with you, Sam?
Oh, gosh. Where do you want me to start? Look, I'll list a few and you tell me which one you want me to pull apart. Look, let me go for smartwatch as a start. That's one of the things that is listed on there. And I'm going to use my own son as an example here. So my son has intellectual disability, but he's actually, we've been able to give him a lot more independence in his life because of his smartwatch, right? So he can go to the bus and catch a bus into town. He can't catch any bus anywhere, but he can catch his bus into town. He's been trained to do that. About 3-4 weeks ago, he was running to the bus stop and he fell over hard. He ripped apart his hands. Yep, the absolute disaster. But he was in this mind space and blood space where he couldn't get out his phone and call me. But his smartwatch sent me the message that said he'd fallen. I was able to call him on the smartwatch and talk to him. I was able to jump in my car and drive around the corner to where he was because I knew where he was because of his smartwatch, which has a Find My Friends feature on it. And I was able to look after him, clean him up, take him straight to the doctors, get him all dressed up and looked after. Now, if we hadn't had the falls alert or if he hadn't had his smartwatch, I think he probably would have been lying there until somebody on the street found him. He may or may not have been able to tell who he was and how to contact me. They probably would have called an ambulance that would have taken him to the hospital. You can see where this is going, right? This is a spiral of ick. And then if he'd gone to the hospital and been treated there, he probably wouldn't have allowed them to touch his hands. Whereas when I was with him at the local doctor that he knows, everything was okay. And there's this lack of a spiral of disaster because I was able to be around and grab him, or somebody that he knows was able to do all of that. So there's one little example there.
Can I add to that, Sam?
Yeah.
What I think a smartwatch would also provide was a sense of confidence for you as, you know, his
100%.
Mom. But hey, he's in jail and maybe he might fall over, but it's going to be okay. The alternative of him leaving the house with a support worker would be, you know, you pay off the smartwatch in the first, you know, day. So, yeah. How about we take this in turns, just so we can hear from Chris, and then we'll come back.
I can give you some more stuff around the smartwatch as well, because there's lots of other ones useful too, if you want. Yeah?
Yeah, go on.
So the watch monitors his step count, but it also manages his gait. So it tells me if he's favouring one side of his body more than the other. The Apple Watch does that. And he shares his data with me. He's happy to do that. So I can look in on his Apple Watch health data, and I can see that if he is starting to favor one side of his body over the other, that he has probably hurt his hip or he's got something going on. And I can say to him, are you okay, Ben? What's happening? It looks like this is, you know, are you hurting somewhere? Now, he's not going to identify and tell me that unless I come to him and have those questions, right? Many people with intellectual disability are not necessarily going to be able to identify what's going on with their bodies in quite such an easy way as other people might. So it will tell me if his gait is changing. I can find out that, yes, he's got an inflammation in his hip and we're going to get that fixed up. If we leave that and we leave that for 6 months or 12 months, we're going to do more and more damage to his body, which is going to require more and more care as he gets older. So this is about preventative care. Now, you can say that's health, but it's actually the disability that's preventing him from identifying the health issue and managing it and dealing with it. So that's where the smartwatch can be helpful.
Chris, you were making decisions around this. What did you do when someone came to you and wanted a smartwatch, for example?
Yeah, it's a great question. I'm going to take a step back and just build on what Sam has said just then, because I think this example is really, really important to make a bigger point. You've mentioned, Sam, that your son avoided a trip to the hospital. What's a day in a hospital bed cost? The federal government contributes to health costs as well, so it's co-funded arrangements. I think if we take a bigger systems look at this, George and Sam, the original intent of the NDIS, it was stated specifically to reduce bed block in places like prisons, in places like hospitals. The provision of a smartwatch, well, I'm a bit out of touch with these things. I don't wear one, but $400.
Chris, I did a full cost analysis on this. The annual total for a smartwatch, assuming it survives for 3 years, is about $410, including the extra GPS part of that. And one fall with an ER visit, 3 follow-up doctor appointments, support workers, extra support workers required, potentially a guardianship hearing, because when he goes to the hospital, he's not going to allow them to look at his hands, right? So all of these costs, I don't even know what that part would cost, but minimum event cost for that one is for $5,200, minimum event.
It's a pretty good return on investment.
Huge investment.
Totally. And we could sit here for the rest of your podcast, George, and go through the 149 items in day-to-day living costs, and we could play whack-a-mole with them. We could together imagine situations where they would pass the pub test for certain people in certain circumstances. I just want to sit with that feeling, and I know you, George, in a very powerful piece written for the conversation, this is a week where the Royal Commission report has landed, the government response to the Royal Commission report, and you expressed deep disappointment, I think were your words, in the conversation article. Dana expressed deep disappointment publicly about the response. And now we have 14 days to respond to what is reams and reams of paper that demand unpaid intellectual labour, both by underfunded advocacy organisations and people with disability who've borne their souls for the Royal Commission report. I think I think there's something that is missing that doesn't pass the pub test about this process for me. And I don't know whether to proceed with tearing apart this list or whether to bang on about the process and the process that isn't, I don't think personally, and it's not for me to decide what co-design is, but it's not living up to what I perceive our governments are capable of doing alongside the disability community.
I think that you nailed it there. It's absolutely critical that the government does follow up on its promise to us around co-design, and that we are clear that we expect more than 14 days for something this critical. I do, though, want to get into a few more of those things on the list. I saw that there was backup power generators and batteries in there, and I thought back to two young men in WA who died because the power went out in a storm. And I think of more people dying when we're not willing to consider this disability need, which it is, to breathe. What are your thoughts, Sam?
I think that's a tough one, and there's been some AAT rulings on this, and I think Chris can probably speak to that better than I can. But I suspect NDIS would say that that's a health-related need to keep them breathing. Therefore, it should be the health department that should be funding a generator. I don't want to go, I can't go a lot deeper than that, other than obviously that was an incredibly devastating event. It was an absolute tragedy. But I do think that an important piece that connects this back to these lists is that the lists are working very hard to push back on other government services. Health being a big one, and when you read the lists, you know it's more clearly identifying what should be the responsibility of a health department or the education department or child protection, for example, in the justice system. So it's a bit like the old Aptos lists, but there's a little bit more in there. But I think Chris can probably talk to the former AAT rulings on that.
Yeah, I mean, there's so many AAT rulings on so many of these supports, right? Gym memberships, we could talk about Mulligan, yeah. We could talk about the instances of vehicles, we could talk about Barling, we could talk about sex work, we could talk about WRMF versus, like, we could go through and talk about what the courts have said about this or what the tribunals have said about this, but again, I think what I'd love to not lose in this as well is the investment frame, the framing of value for money, which the value of effective and beneficial. And I think we are starting to step away from that language in the new framework plans. How do we ensure that the therapies that are being provided are, you know, effective and beneficial for the person receiving them? It's okay to set up a working group within the agency that looks at these questions. I think that's important. And the CEO this morning or this week committed to ensuring that people with lived experience of disability are on that. But I think as well, it's really tricky because people are experts in their own lives as well. And I think we need to acknowledge that expertise. I think, Sam, what you mentioned about the cost shifting between health and NDIS and education and NDIS and employment is a huge one in this list, right? And I'll deflect back to you on this in a sec, Sam, but for me, justice, right, we're seeing a shrinkage here in the justice, what's written about justice. You know, there's a kind of out, they focus solely on exclusions in justice, but we know the Aptos principles do look at what is included in terms of NDIS responsibility in justice and things like capacity building supports and things like, you know, transitions out and coordination that of NDIS related supports.
Yes, you're so right. One of the controversial topics that we often deal with in the self-direction and self-management space is short-term accommodation and respites. What I'm feeling in this list is a real push to force people, essentially, to use the disability service response rather than the community response. Sam, you have done a lot of work with respect to this. What are your thoughts?
They definitely are pushing back and looking at effectively pushing people into grouped type respite arrangements. And that is a worry. And I want to extend that it's not just short-term accommodation. It's all community activities. So you can no longer be using any under this potential list that you can't use your funding to join any community recreation or group. So if you're a little kid and you want to do a dance class, you are going to be, if you're a family that doesn't have good funding, good money, as in your own money, you're going to put your child in a specialist disability dancing class because that's the only one you're allowed to use your money on, your NDIS funds on, because you're not going to be able to use it for a regular community group. And if you're a 12-year-old who would normally, without disability, run down to the local basketball courts and shoot some hoops on your own, because that's what 12-year-olds do, if you can't do that because of your disability, you should be able to spend your money on going to the local hoops basketball group that's down at the courts, because you've got some supervision and support there. This doesn't allow for that. So you're then going to, like I say, we're going to have this over-reliance on support workers, and little Jimmy is going to be going down to the local basketball court shooting hoops with his worker, which is not going to build him any friendships. It's going to cost more. It just doesn't achieve any of what we really want the scheme to achieve. Just doesn't reduce costs and doesn't increase participation and belonging in community. And that's a problem. And I think we're going to see the same with that short-term accommodation piece as well.
Yes, it's concerning. A lot of parents have said to me that the children who are on the NDIS, but they won't go to a respite centre, so they will not get any respite. Do you see that as a probable outcome, Sam?
I can say that I never sent my son to respite under old systems for that very reason, because they would have put him in with, you know, children that were much older, or you would put you wouldn't want to put an 18-year-old in respite with 60-year-olds, would you? That's not viable.
So I think that the problem that the government is trying to solve is that they see people spending their NDIS funding on cruises and on things that sound like a lot of fun.
The optics are really poor. Of course, it looks terrible on the front page of the Daily Telly, doesn't it?
What are your thoughts on that? How do we address the issue of people not spending all their money on cruises, and at the same time allowing people and enabling people to get really good outcomes from not going to respite centres?
I think the new legislation already tries to address that by limiting the package size so that you can't keep going back. You can't blow all your funds on cruises and respite and then come back and say, I need someone to come and help me shower because I've run out of all my money because I used it all up going on cruises. If we're actually supporting participants to use their funds appropriately, if we've got a good navigator or coordinator or whatever, LAC, whatever system you want to call it, if we've got good systems and good supports in there, then it'll be okay. And if people do muck up in one plan, then we've got to support them more. And if they continue to muck up, well, then we put them into agency management and we lock down the amount that can be spent on respite. I mean, we've already got all of these mechanisms in place, to be fair. The agency just hasn't employed them.
I'd like to think again about the the list, and I saw that rent is there, is you can't spend it on rent, which makes sense when you consider that rent is an expense that most people who don't own a house have. But people also can do some really excellent home and living arrangements by subsidizing their rent in a house share arrangement. I've seen those work very effectively. What are your thoughts on rent? It's a very controversial one.
I don't think it's controversial at all. If you're a person with disability that requires overnight supports and you have to rent a three-bedroom house instead of a two-bedroom house, then that third bedroom should be claimable. Now, whether that third person is an unpaid person or a support worker is almost irrelevant. But the rent of that extra bedroom, if it is required solely and purely directly because of your disability-related needs, then what are people supposed to do? Rent is so expensive. And if you have to have an extra bedroom to meet your requirements under Fair Work, which is actually the case, then how can that not be claimable?
Because other changes are also around employment and employment supports.
Yeah, I've been sitting with employment for a little bit, and there's this description about workplace assistance, this is what's in, that enables a participant to successfully obtain and or retain employment in the open or supported labour market, including individual employment support. Now, it's got this list of carve-outs as well, which does not include learning and support needs of students that primarily relate to their education and training. Work-specific support related to recruitment processes, work adjustments, or the working environment, funding or provision of employment services and programs. I just think that's incredibly complex. We've got carve-outs, and then we've got carve-outs on carve-outs. And I wonder, again, employment is one of the areas that we really haven't seen enough progress in. And so any kind of limiting or reducing in the area of employment seems to me to be one of the really important areas that we can't afford to reduce choices.
It feels very counterproductive, doesn't it, Chris? One of the things in the employment section too in the out list is that you can't use for transport within work activities. So theoretically, then your employer should be paying for it. But if you're running a micro enterprise or a small business and you're blind and you need to get around, one would think that you would be able to use your NDIS money for that. But this quite clearly says no. So that's a problem.
Before we move on, Sam, are there any other things on the list that really concern you?
Look, there are quite a few things, but I think it's the things that exclude people from general community that upset me the most. And one of those was that list, they list sort of the hairdressers and nail salons. And on the face of it, that seems like, yeah, that's very appropriate. Why should you be using your money for that? But, you know, if you're a participant that can't wash their own hair but can wash your own body, do you really want a support worker in the shower with you to wash your hair? Why wouldn't you go to your local hairdresser, use the very comfortable, you know, the way that you physically makes sense to you to lean back into their proper hair basin and have your hair washed twice a week at, what, $20, instead of having a support worker that costs, you know, $70 an hour in your home looking at you naked in the shower? I can't understand why it would make sense to spend, you know, $14,000 a year on having a support worker come 2 hours twice a week to your home versus going to the hairdresser twice a week where you get known and you're in your community and you're at your shopping centre and you know, who knows, you might end up getting a job doing the books for the hairdresser because you've built this relationship with a local business. I don't know. There's all these different options, and that's going to cost you $2,000 a year out of a plan instead of $14,000. I really struggle with that.
Chris, yourself?
Yeah, there's, in terms of dating or relationship services, that's out. And I mean, again, I don't think I'm the person who should be deciding, you know, like menstrual supports, like pads, and that's on the out list. I can think of so many circumstances where those supports are directly disability related and are reasonable and necessary. So I, again, I just want to express that I'm not the person to be flagging what should and should not be in. And I think there needs to be a wider process of engagement for these sorts of questions.
It feels like a lot of that stuff is just really clumsy, because when they say dating services, I think they're talking about, you know, subscription to Grindr or Tinder or whatever, rather than services that are actually supporting people with intellectual disability to understand consent and to introduce each other to other people. Those sorts of things make sense to me, but when you read the list, it makes it look like they're in the out list. That's potentially a profound problem. But like Chris said, we can argue about these little nitty-gritty, all of these little things, which are very big for certain individuals. But I think the process that's happening over the next 2 weeks will address that. I think what we really need to think about is that bigger picture. And do we really want in and out lists? You know, my understanding is that we have to have an in list and that it can be quite broad under administrative law, but that the out list has to be quite specific under administrative law. So that makes me very nervous.
Then what can we do to improve this situation? Because the government has asked for our views. What should we be saying?
I usually really like to have solutions, and I don't feel like I've got one. My gut's telling me, stop, put the brakes on. This is too fast. We've not co-designed this. We're not ready for this. This is not the right way to go. This list is more about optics than it is actually about saving money or about getting good outcomes for people. But I think the train is already rolling down the hill. I don't know how we're going to do this and make this better. We can talk about adding in the smartwatch and the hairdresser, but there's a bigger piece to this. We don't have a response to the NDIS review yet. We don't have a response from the government.
Chris?
Yeah, I think that, again, that bigger picture stuff is how do we talk about these issues in the media without depicting disabled people as greedy, as opulent, as trying to take the scheme for a ride? Sailing around on yachts. How do we have a mature conversation? But I know, like, I'm speaking to your listeners, George. I'd be speaking to the converted, I imagine, here. But I think people are going to turn out in big ways and provide their feedback to the government. I think that's going to happen. And as Sam said, we're going to get the things in and out. But I think that the bigger piece is the states will also be having frustrating conversations with the Commonwealth at the moment. They're in the middle of very important negotiations about what foundational supports could look like and what the funding agreements look like. And I just think that we can't lose sight of the bigger investment frame that this world-leading scheme was set up to do. We need to think long game. We need to think about value for money and effective and beneficial. We need to think about investment. And I guess I would also call on the media to pick up our game. And I count myself as someone who writes about the NDIS in this space as well. I think we need to do better at telling stories, not at the kind of boundaries or like extremes, but rather stories that humanize and stories that see people where they're at.
That's absolutely right, Chris. And if when I look at this document, I see discrimination and injustice. because how many people in particular with intellectual disability will be able to learn this list off by heart and know that they haven't bought something that's, you know, on the list, and then they're going to end up with a debt, and we know what happens in those situations. So I just think that whatever we do here, it needs to be easy, and it needs to focus on principles. And those principles are, it's disability-related, and it's something that you use to achieve outcomes that you need because of your disability. And that takes about one page, you know, and rule out gambling, rule out, you know, illicit drugs, and rule out clairvoyance if you have to.
Yeah.
That's fair. But, you know, 14 pages is just too difficult.
It feels like the list should have those out things that you just mentioned, George, and then the in things should be as simple as anything that you wouldn't have to buy if you weren't disabled.
I agree. Before we wrap up, any final thoughts? Start with you, Chris.
I guess I just want to thank you, George, for the work you're doing in this space and your listeners. I think it's a really hard time, and I think we need to take care of ourselves and take care of each other, check in with each other. And there's a process ahead of us, and there's a long journey ahead of us. The second tranche of legislation hasn't arrived yet. They were mentioning that today in the Senate inquiry. So I think we need to, again, it's that tension of, do we pace ourselves knowing that other people have our backs, or do we step up and grind away knowing that that takes a very serious toll? I, like Sam said, I don't have the answers about that question, but
Sam?
I wish that there is a way in this legislation for there to be exemptions, so exclusions, or some sort of mechanism where somebody can say, look, I know that trampolines are not appropriate for most people in most situations, but, you know, my situation is really extraordinary. I'm a 35-year-old with a profound intellectual disability and behavioral support needs, and I burn through a trampoline every 6 months. And if I don't have a trampoline, I'll tear my house to pieces. Now, there's got to be a mechanism to allow things like that to be spent, not necessarily funded, not necessarily extra funding, but for you to prioritize the use of the funding that you've got to achieve those decent outcomes. And I want to echo what Chris said. This is a really tough time for everyone. I mean, I'm exhausted. I spent most of the weekend reading, analyzing this legislation, analyzing the response to the task force on workforce registration. There is so much coming at us every single day. And I just want to say, I feel for everyone, because I think we're all feeling it right now. Every few months, it feels like we're coming to a peak of stuff we have to do and respond to, but then there's another peak, and it just keeps getting higher and higher, more and more work. So hope everyone takes care. And thank you, George, for your leadership here and running these podcasts and whipping us into line and getting us on the screen. So thank you.
Thank you, Sam. Thank you, Chris. And for all of our listeners, do take care. And remember that this isn't as yet at the time of this recording. This isn't the law. You can still have your say, and I encourage everyone to get involved, have your say, and do what we've always done, and that is fight for what's right. I think it's important.
Can I add a disclaimer, George, that I'm not a lawyer and this isn't legal advice? So
yeah, neither.
Do get advocacy if it's available to you to understand how these proposed laws might impact your situation. But certainly don't take our words about legislation that's proposed about a legislative instrument that's proposed as gospel.
Yeah, get involved with your local disability representative organisations. Go talk to your peak body, become a member, support them.
Yeah, support them so they can support you. Thanks, guys. Thanks for the time. Bye-bye.
Bye.
See ya.
That's all the time for on today's episode of Visible and Necessary. As you know, we love your feedback, so please share your thoughts with us in the comment section below. Thanks for listening, and until next time, stay well and reasonable.